Bibliophiles of the internet, get on in here, babes, because today I'm talking about non-binary romances. I recently got a very lovely comment from someone on my June recap where they said they had recently come out as non-binary this year. Very happy for you, by the way, congratulations. And so they're looking for romance books about non-binary characters, preferably characters who use they-them pronouns. Hello, in case you're new here, I am an actual non-binary person whose pronouns are they-them, and even though I do read across genres, I do read a fair amount of trad pub and indie pub romances, so I do consider myself somewhat knowledgeable on this subject. I do want to make a few notes before I get started. First of all, as always, this is not intended to be a complete list. Please do not take it as such. It never could be that, so it's not. It also leans a little bit more on the trad pub side because I'm still kind of breaking into the indie romance scene myself, but I promise you, if you expand your search into indie romances, you will absolutely find more books like this. I do also want to note that my focus here was searching for romances, meaning stories where the romantic relationships are the central topic or conflict that center non-binary characters. Most of them do use they-them pronouns as requested. One or two of them might use different pronouns or multiple pronouns, and that's okay. Those of us who are non-binary basically get to make the rules. We can use whatever words or terms or language or pronouns that we want. I think that's all the housekeeping stuff. Also, I do have this organized by YA romance and then adult romance afterwards, so enjoy, be cool, and trust the process. First up, I would not be able to show my face in public if I didn't start with Andra and Santi Were Here by Johnny Gazavilla. This book is a YA contemporary romance about a Mexican-American artist named Ander who wants to take a year between college and graduation to build their portfolio, live some life, and just focus on their art without any distractions. To that end, their family actually owns and operates a taqueria in San Antonio where Ander has been working for quite some time, but in support of their dream, their family decides to fire them from the taqueria and hire someone else in their place. Enter Santi, the hot new waiter that Ander's family has hired, and of course Ander has to help him learn the ropes, show him around, all that good stuff, and if they happen to fall in love in the process, well, that's just how it goes. This book is so wonderful for a whole myriad of reasons. Notably, it's one of the few YA romances out there featuring an AMAB non-binary character, which is something that we don't see enough, and we absolutely should be interrogating why that is. But also, even though Ander and Santi are facing down some pretty significant problems, namely the threat of deportation where Santi is concerned because of his immigrant status, there is so much cathartic joy and healing to be found in this story. I love that Ander belongs to a very queer normative community and family. Their family never once misgenders them or disrespects them, and even though they're primarily Spanish-speaking, they always use inclusive Spanish, which is a huge deal and sets a very important precedent even beyond the boundaries of fiction. This is the kind of romance that is deeply emotional but will also have you laughing out loud. It's vibrant, it's full of life, and it's just this amazing story about these two queer Mexican kids falling in love. And if you ask me, that makes it perfect. Next is another book that could not be excluded from this list, perhaps one of the first groundbreaking YA romances about a non-binary protagonist, and that is, of course, I Wish You All the Best by Mason Deaver. To be fair, the story leans a little bit more towards coming of age, but the romance is definitely a significant piece of it and also an essential piece in that coming of age journey. It's about a non-binary teen named Ben who comes out to their parents and is immediately kicked out of the house. So they call up their estranged sister Hannah, who tells them to come move in with her and her new husband. So they do, and they get the chance to not only potentially heal that relationship, but also start over in a new place. But of course, moving somewhere new means finding a new normal, going to a new school, making new friends, and despite their best efforts to go unnoticed, Ben is taken under the wing of a sweet, funny, charismatic boy named Nathan. This story is a great starting point when it comes to non-binary romance. Again, it definitely explores difficult topics like disownment, family estrangement, transphobia, mental health, all of that stuff. But at the end of the day, it's a beautiful story about a non-binary kid finding their footing and falling in love. And even though it doesn't shy away from those hardships and difficulties, I think it's also a story that offers a lot of healing in showing how Ben deserves safety, acceptance, love, gentleness, and most importantly, space to be themselves and grow into the person they're supposed to be. While we're on the Mason Deaver train, we also have to talk about The Feeling of Falling in Love. This is a hilarious T4T YA rom-com about a trans boy named Neil who's getting ready to fly across the country to go to his brother's wedding over spring break. He was planning to take his current friends with benefits, Josh, as his plus one, but when Josh actually confesses that he's in love with Neil, Neil immediately ends the relationship. So now Neil is desperately looking for a new wedding date. He is dreading the possibility of going to this huge family event by himself, and as a last-ditch effort to avoid that scenario, he decides to invite Wyatt, his roommate. To be perfectly clear, the main character of this story is a binary trans boy, which is awesome, but his love interest, Wyatt, is discovering their non-binary identity and exploring different kinds of expression as the story progresses. This book is so chaotic, it's so funny, it's that classic rom-com setup with the hired wedding date trope that straights have gotten since like the dawn of time, but make it 10 times more chaotic and extremely trans. I would also recommend The One True Me and You by Remy K. England, also known as M.K. England. This is a super nerdy queer YA romance about Kay, who can't wait to go to this convention called GreatCon, where she's going to be with a bunch of her fandom friends and also potentially use her fanfic expertise to take part in a con-sponsored publishing contest. Kay has three main goals for the weekend: to try out they-them pronouns in public, to do a more mask-presenting cosplay, and to kiss a girl for the first time. It turns out that the hotel the convention is being held in is actually hosting two events at the same time: GreatCon and the Miss Cosmic Teen USA pageant. So that throws Tegan into Kay's path. She's taking part in the pageant and also secretly queer and dying to go to GreatCon. Tegan figures she just needs to make it through this weekend without raising any red flags, but things get a little bit complicated when Kay starts helping her sneak into GreatCon events, and also the two of them start hanging out in each other's rooms after hours. This is such a fun and underrated queer YA romance. It's unapologetically nerdy and really deep dives into the complexities and pitfalls of fandom, along with all of its beautiful possibilities. And in terms of non-binary romance, I think this story is really invaluable because it gives Kay the space to explore their gender, to show how conventions and fandom can provide space for people to safely explore and express those kinds of things in so many ways. This is just a fast-paced, romantic, heartfelt story that really makes a meal out of convention shenanigans, and I think very successfully pulls off these two ambitious character parallels that revolve around sense of self and queerness. Next, we gotta talk about one of my most recent favorites, written by one of my all-time favorite authors, and that is Spellbound by F.T. Lukens. F.T. Lukens has really made a name for themselves in the space of satirical queer fantasy romances. I think a lot of their books could actually be classified as cozy fantasy for a lot of different reasons. This one begins with Rook, who recently lost his grandmother, who unfortunately was his only remaining connection to magic. Rook doesn't have magic himself, but that doesn't stop him from bursting into Antonia Hex's call center for magical emergencies and basically demanding a job. She graciously allows him to be her non-magical secretary, but she doesn't know that he actually has an illegal magic-detecting device of his own invention that he's secretly trying to perfect. When the magical consortium catches wind of this device, they capture Antonia and her rival Fable in retaliation. So now if they want to rescue their mentors, Rook will have to team up with Sun, Fable's grumpy and annoyingly cute apprentice. Again, to be clear, Sun is non-binary and uses they-them pronouns. The story is actually told in alternating POV chapters, so both Sun and Rook are the main characters. This story is just delightful. If I've said it once, I've said it 100 times, but if there's one guarantee in life, it's that you're gonna have a damn good time whenever you pick up something written by F.T. Lukens. There's so much to enjoy in this story. It has that frenemies to begrudging allies to friends to lovers kind of energy. There's magical mishaps and hijinks, forced proximity, tender romance, all that good stuff. And if that's not a strong enough sell, the story also explores issues of access, scarcity of resources, and provides a very strong argument railing against the dangers of exclusion and gatekeeping, again, all wrapped up in a really fantastic romance. I would be remiss if I didn't mention Lake Lore by A.M. McLemore. This is queer YA romance, it's also magical realism, and the story is about two non-binary neurodivergent Nethine teenagers, Bastian and Lore, who live near this mysterious lake that hides a wondrous ethereal world beneath the surface. Bastian and Lore are the only two people in this town who have actually ventured into that world, but when the world beneath the lake begins to bleed into their everyday lives, they will have to work together if they want to avoid the lake also bringing their own secrets to light. I don't like to use this word often, but this book is a blessing. We don't often get stories like this that center non-binary identity, neurodivergence, Latinidad, and queer romance, and I think it's wonderful how the story celebrates the intersections of those experiences without ever once demonizing their complexity. I also really appreciate this story for the nuances it brings to non-binary identity. Both of these characters are non-binary and equally non-binary in every sense, even though their experiences and forms of expression are very different. And yes, I would absolutely classify this as a romance, as most of A.M. McLemore's books are, because it's about these two characters finding a sense of freedom from connecting with someone else who sees them and values them for the entirety of who they are, rather than just the most convenient pieces. I also highly recommend the audiobook for this one if you can access it, because it's actually read by two queer non-binary Latina narrators and two of the best in the business, Avi Roque and Vico Ortiz. Now we're moving into adult romance, and for that we're going to start with Love and Other Disasters by Anita Kelly. This is an adult romance, like I said, that takes place during a cooking competition. We follow Dahlia, who's recently divorced and really gunning for the prize money in this competition show so that she can start over and reinvent herself. Our other main character is a non-binary amateur chef named London, who's using this reality show as a chance to publicly share their identity and pronouns for the first time. And of course, they want to prove the haters and naysayers wrong by winning the whole thing. After a very messy and awkward meet-cute, these two start spending more time together off-camera, but then they have to decide whether or not their relationship is worth risking this potentially life-changing prize. This romance is positively brimming with a lot of delightful romance tropes. Obviously, there's the reality TV trope, the competitors-turned-lovers trope, the grumpy sunshine trope. It's also not a second-chance romance story, but rather a second-chance-at-romance. So it's a lot of fun to read. I'm someone who loves a good cooking show, and I think this book caters to that, no pun intended, so incredibly well. There's a great mixture of romantic moments and cooking content, and I feel like you almost get to know the characters even better through their cooking in some ways. There's also pretty high emotional stakes here, because both characters desperately want to win this competition for their own reasons, and obviously they have to work through if and how this budding relationship might change those priorities. I'm gonna switch things up by recommending a historical romance. I did actually mention this one in my June recap video, but it deserves to be shouted from the mountaintops at any and every opportunity, and that is Unmasked by the Marquess by Kat Sebastian. This is like a gender-bent, mistaken identity kind of story. It's about Robert Selby, who wants nothing more than to see his sister make an advantageous match, but there's two major problems. The Selbys have no money, no status, and no connections, and Robert is actually a disguised housemaid named Charity Church. Enter Alistair, the Marquess of Pembroke, who spent years of his life trying to repair his family's estate that his late father had run into the ground. His sole purpose in life is protecting that fortune and restoring his family's social image. One day, Robert comes to Alistair's doorstep asking for Alistair to help introduce Robert's sister into high society. After instantly refusing this favor, Alistair just can't stop thinking about this impertinent young man and all the disreputable things that Alistair might want to do with him. As I said in my June recap video, Charity eventually goes by the name Robin, which is what I will be calling her, and she also is canonically non-binary, even though she doesn't have access to those terms or concepts, and she does use she/her pronouns, just like a lot of very real non-binary folks do. I love this romance because it's so vigorously going against the grain of what we would expect from a stereotypical Regency romance. It really is unapologetically, unabashedly queer in every imaginable way. There is no crisis of identity for Robin. She knows exactly who she is and what she wants. It's almost doubly queer because these two connect and fall for each other while Alistair firmly believes that Robin is a man, and when he learns that she's neither man nor woman, it's almost like getting to know her again and falling for her again. They're both very righteous, very duty-bound people. They feel a very strong responsibility to those they care about, and ultimately I think the story is about both of them learning that they also have a responsibility to be true to themselves. We're gonna end with some adult indie romance, starting with Heart Haunt Havoc by Freydis Moon. This is a genre blend of horror and romance. We follow a trans exorcist slash witch priest named Colin, who finds himself challenged by an especially unruly haunted house when he's hired to come cleanse it by the handsome non-binary homeowner, Bishop Martinez. It's not your usual ghosts and demons residing in this house, but for some reason there's a whole plethora of inhuman and undead creatures inhabiting this home, including a vengeful wolf-headed spirit who might be the cause of Bishop's sleepless nights. But as Colin painstakingly unravels this mystery, he's coming face to face with a past that Bishop has tried and failed to bury, and he won't be able to save them if they don't relinquish their long-kept secrets. I've seen some folks call this a weirdly cozy horror romance, and I think that's a perfect descriptor. Even though you wouldn't expect it to, the story strikes a really fine balance between creepy, unsettling scenes and domestically intimate moments. That word, intimate, really speaks to the nature of this haunting. It's deeply personal, it's deeply vulnerable, and for Bishop to welcome Colin into that space, both literally and metaphorically, is part of what makes their relationship so powerful. They're facing these horrific things together. They're expressing and processing processing fear with each other in real time. And I think this romance is so satisfying because it's about these characters fighting to reclaim something, whether that's a home, a body, an identity, a sense of safety, that should always have been theirs in the first place. Speaking of Fridis, I would once again be remiss if I failed to mention With a Vengeance. This is a much darker, much more fucked up queer erotic romance that's also on the paranormal side. It's following Kai, who's returning to their hometown because their estranged mother has recently passed, and they have to go through her things and settle her affairs. Kai already struggles with substance abuse, depression, and dissociative episodes, but being back home seems to make things worse, and also seems to intensify an intrusive voice that plagues their every thought. One night, Kai comes face to face with the shadowy presence living in their head, a handsome demon duke, Eli, who offers to help Kai through this painful period by giving them access to as much pain, pleasure, and power as they can handle for the very affordable price of their soul. Like I said, this is a much darker romance. Fridis always does a great job of making content warnings accessible for their story, so definitely look up those beforehand, but this story is a wild ride, to say the very least. Much like Heart Hunt Havoc, even though the story is literally about demonic possession, it is unexpectedly intimate and domestic. There's a closeness to the story as Kai and Eli share space in this abandoned house, as Eli bears witness to all of the emotional turmoil that Kai is both experiencing and avoiding, and as Eli also gives Kai the tools and the permission to liberate their innate power. It's really a story about learning to own up to all the dark, messy, unsavory, complicated parts of yourself without remorse, and surprisingly, the romance has a very reciprocal, evocative kind of dynamic. Lastly, I have to talk about Our Bloody Pearl by Deanne Brin. This is an adult fantasy romance. It's about pirates, sirens, maybe some cool steampunk elements in the mix. It's about a non-binary disabled siren named Pearl who's been captured and injured by a ruthless pirate captain who's trying to invent a device that will cancel out siren songs. With a muted song and tail paralysis, Pearl's only chance for escape would be a dramatic rescue. And just when they're about to lose hope, a second pirate vessel overtakes the first. Suddenly, there's a new captain who's all kindness and all smiles and promises that Pearl is no longer in danger and that he wants to protect them and help them in whatever way he can. But can he be trusted? I first read this in 2019, and I still think about it all the time. It has all the adventure, action, and swashbuckling you would expect from any good pirate story, but it's also centered around an incredibly soft and tender romance. Every romance in some way is about connection, but this story takes that to a new level because there's all kinds of barriers between these two characters. There's a difference in species, a difference in culture, a difference in speech and language, with Pearl being nonverbal. So to see the time and effort these characters put into gaining each other there's trust and painstakingly establishing that connection, not out of urgency, but out of intentionality, is a really powerful thing to witness. So it's really about that emotional exchange. It's about these characters helping each other to engage with their own traumas in gentle and healthy ways and bolstering each other so that they can fight for a future they both want. So those are some non-binary romances that I have personally read and would recommend. Some I've heard good things about and would suggest you look into would include Chef's Kiss by TJ Alexander, Larkin Kasim Start a Revolution by Kaysen Callender, and Documenting Light by E.E. Ottoman. Of course, I would love to hear about any non-binary romances that you would recommend, especially those with BIPOC and otherwise marginalized characters. So feel free to drop those down below in the comments. But that's everything I had to recommend for today. Thank you so much for watching, and until next time, educate yourself, be kind to yourself, take care of yourself, and I will catch you on the flip side of the page.